Well, you could...
The Macho Man, Randy Savage. What do you have there,
Mr. Let me read the sign up there. Hold that end up there. It makes me happy, yeah. 1, 2, 3. Macho Man is the champion, yeah. Wow. Take it away. Unbelievable right there. What are you, head waiter? Huh? Don't unbelievable things happen.
Could be.
Now, here's what it goes. Tito Santana, 1986. Hulk Hogan, 1986. Winning the belts from you is going to be easier than, hold this, taking candy away from a baby. Unbelievable. I could take all the candy and pour it on your head right now. But I ain't gonna. I'm gonna pour it over mine. Cause I ain't got no dignity. No, I don't. Not when it comes to winning a World Heavyweight Championship belt. Aren't I something, man? Did you see me out here putting candy on my head?
Take, Macho Man. Macho.
Right there.
Macho Man.
Okay, yeah.
Elizabeth has been a big part of your success.
Yeah.
Certainly, she is a very attractive addition to the World Wrestling Federation. You give her a lot of credit, do you not?
Why shouldn't I put candy on your head right now? But I could take it right behind myself and throw it right on Elizabeth. Or I can take these glasses and smash them against my head. Show the intensity that I want. The World Heavyweight Championship belt. Elizabeth, get out of here right now. Get out of here.
How can you dismiss her like that?
I dismiss her like I'm dismissing Hulk Hogan, yeah. Hulk Hogan, man, understand that the belt will fall in 86. The World Heavyweight Championship belt will fall in 1986.
Now, is that a prediction or is that a promise?
It's a promise, yes it is. And I promise to you, the public out there, that you'll have a champion that you can be proud of. The world's greatest athlete. Ask Tito Santana what he is. He's a stepping stone to the World Heavyweight Championship belt. And I guarantee you, Elizabeth, and anybody out there, don't bet against the Macho Man. Not this year.
Oh. Thank you, Randy Savage. Randy Savage certainly has done.
We had a whole lot of superstars on this stage here tonight. But I want y'all to know one thing. This is my house. And when I say who's house.
Word attack skills and vocabulary too. I've been hitting the distant distance, it's all brand new. You're through. I'm interplanetary like Doctor Who. So who?
Fuck your beef, no relief. I step on stage, girls scream like I'm Keith.
Class is in session. Retail Pro Wrestling is here at it again. Keith and Keshia in the building. Keshia, say hi to the people.
Hello, everyone. I miss you.
We are running this show with a full roster. The entire team is in the building, ready to talk wrestling, ready to talk about the week that was in professional wrestling, what's coming up. Mm-hmm. We are on the road to WrestleMania. We are about, I want to say, 2 weeks out from WrestleMania, right? Whole Sundays. Because tomorrow will actually be 2 weeks. So about 15 days. There's a lot to go on. There's a lot to unpack. We're going to go through it. This show, we are going to discuss what that road looks like. We are going to discuss the big elephant in the room called Kofi Kingston. Because Kofi has become the biggest storyline in probably wrestling right now. Which, hey, did you think that that was going to be this way? 2 weeks ago, a month ago, 2 months ago? No, I mean, like, before we got the fast lane, did we have that thought? No.
Nah,
but here we are. Here we are, Keish. Interesting. So, we're going to talk about it. Get a little catch up, because since you ain't have sat down with the family in a while, what's going on? Well, I mean, with the family, I mean, the internet. Wrestling internet. Because the family, us, we sat down recently. But
right. This is
Anything you want to talk about? Anything you've seen in these wrestling streets that's really perturbing you right now? Outside of the main topics that we're going to hit later on in the show.
Outside of the main topics? No.
Okay.
I got a lot to say about the main topics.
Okay, cool,
I'm going to jump on this soapbox a little bit tonight, because I'm telling you.
Yeah.
Is that what I have been seeing in wrestling recently has been perturbing me, irritating me. And I swear it's like the comments and the just, yeah, I'm going to get into all of that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's some things that's been going down on the internet that I'm like, y'all fuckers are saying this shit? Okay. It's very
right,
weird.
Right.
So I want to get to it. I want to make sure all bases are covered. Because there's a lot to say. And it's going to be fun. That's about it. It's live. You know, one thing I got to do with this show is figure out how to let y'all get included. So, the chat room is open, right? And I can see the chat room. But, I can't, like, I got to figure out a way for y'all to call in.
Yeah.
I have to be able to manage that some kind of way. Because I think that would be, we had that at Blog Talk. And I need to figure out a way to bring that back. Just try to make sure I'm not echoing. Okay. Whew. All right. So let's get into it. So we have Raw, right? Raw opens up this week. Lesnar's there, which is very rare, but Lesnar shows up to Raw.
Right.
Heyman's in tow, of course. They talk and they smack. Drew McIntyre comes out. Then Seth comes out, whacks McIntyre with a chair, and beats the holy hell out of him with a chair. But this is what I'll say, Keish. I think Drew McIntyre is your next big star on Raw. I don't think he's going to carry the water, but if Seth Rollins needs a nemesis for the next year or so, or 2 years, it's Drew.
Yeah, I can see that. I can definitely see that. Alright, yeah. I can picture that. Like, I can really see that. Especially this ain't the Drew McIntyre that we had before in WWE, so I definitely can feel how much of a improvement to the storyline that would be if he were to be on the opposite side of Seth, you know, on top in the long run. Like, somewhere. It's not far-fetched at all. I actually agree with all of that.
He has to be managed very, very carefully, though, right? Because here's the thing. I've seen Drew work and not work. So, let me give you an example. His first run at WWE was terrible, right?
Right, right.
His run at TNA was amazing. Okay? And I think that was the thing that brought him back. Now, crazy enough, his run at NXT wasn't good. Like, I thought it was boring. Even though he became champion, I thought he was boring.
It was boring.
Right?
It was terrible.
But since coming to the main roster, I got to find a place to put this. So, side note, that noise you just heard was a baseball. Now, it's in a actual package, but where I got it sitting on top of the thing that covers my mic to try to help the sound, it just, I don't know, sometimes it just decides to roll and fall, even in the rectangle, the square packaging that it's in. And
what?
You will
see.
It's the baseball you got me from the Dominican Republic. Strange enough.
I was just about to ask that question.
Yeah. No,
this
is your baseball. For those of y'all who don't know, Keisha's a world traveler. And she brings stuff back sometimes. So, I got a baseball for the Dominican Republic from her, which is an amazing gift because I love baseball. Great baseball players tend to come from the Dominican Republic.
I'm just saying.
So
I didn't know that much.
So
I don't know too much about baseball, but I knew that much. So I figured it'd be a great gift. But how was it rolling by itself in that box?
Like, I don't know, because even like where I got it sitting, the thing is kind of sloped, but it ain't sloped that. I don't know, Keish. I don't know. It may not even roll. Maybe the gravity just slides forward. I don't know. So, either way, I will put on something flat and away from stuff, because it happens routinely, and it might be that I'm shaking the table a little too much when I'm talking. But
yeah, maybe so.
I'm getting back on task. I think Drew is a perfect. Okay, him and Seth work stylistically. They are about the right size for each other. Drew is actually, I feel like, one of the perfect size guys. Okay, not necessarily perfect. Like, perfect size is the classic NWA champion, about 6'2", 240. Drew is about 6'5", 6'6", 260, 270 or so, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But what that does is, he's not so big and massive that if I put him in a ring with Finn Balor, I can't figure out anything for him to do. He's athletic enough, he can move with anybody. But he's also big enough, if I stand him in front of Braun Strowman, you feel like he has a chance. Right?
Right, right. This is true.
If I stand him in front of Brock, you're not scared for his life. So, that's my thing. So, I like Drew. And here's the thing. If, let's say, Brock comes as a babyface and Drew stays, I think Drew's more versatile as a heel. But if he attacks Brock and hits him with a Claymore kick, you'll believe it. That's all I'm saying.
Right.
So,
this is true.
I think he's going to be a good guy to carry it for, right, going forward. So, we had that scenario. I'll leave that there. Finn Balor and Braun Strowman. Oh, yeah. And there's a match that's going to happen later between Drew and Seth. Okay. Finn Balor, he's scheduling a tag team match against Bobby Lashley and Leo Rush. He needs a tag team partner. They were supposed to make it a surprise, but they pretty much spilled the beans. Because even in the show, like, Cole was like, I think it's going to be a monster surprise. Man, who else could it be?
Right, exactly. I hate when they do stuff like that. It's yeah. Know y'all just told everybody, right? Oh, okay. Like, that's not a hint. Like, that's just not... Like, you literally just said it without saying it. Like, what are you doing?
Right.
They definitely have to choose their words wisely. Like, I don't know what made you think that was okay. Like, oh, thank you, Cole. Like, we definitely don't know who it is now. Like, what are you doing? I can't deal with them sometimes. I really can't. Mm-mm. Oh, it's a note that I need to address about the commentary team too. But you know, I get to that a little later.
We can let that go now.
Okay. Because I read that they're talking about getting rid of Renee Young and just having Cole and Corey up
Here's
there together.
The thing. I've heard that, and I've seen people talk about it on the internet, right?
Right.
This is my take. I like Renee. I think it gets a little complicated with Ambrose because, and the funny thing is, since Ambrose is no longer a heel, weird transition, but since he's no longer a heel, it kind of works a little better.
Right.
I honestly think she adds something to the commentary. And I don't think I put this. I wouldn't be ready to jump off the ship with her. And I'm not sure if these rumors aren't starting because Dean is leaving. Right? Because I think that's a foregone conclusion that Dean is going to be gone. So, and I don't know if they're doing this to mess with her since Dean is. Because here's the. When you have couples that are in a company and then one part of the couple decides to leave, you just never know what that means for the other person who stays behind.
Yeah, because I know when Cody left, Randy was still there for a minute, and then she asked for her release like he asked for his.
Right.
And, like, I think that's something that they fear. It's like,
but,
it's like when with CM Punk and AJ Lee.
Yeah.
I think
the situation is different.
One half. Yeah, I guess they figure if one half leaves, the other half is going to leave at some point. Like, they're going to end up wanting to follow their partner and end up leaving, too. And I can understand that fear, but I don't think that that's going to happen in this situation. I feel like that's not going to be the case here. But at the same time, like, I could understand why they are so skeptical on if this is going to be a thing or not, you know? Especially because it's with the other situations, like with Cody, it was more so of, we don't know, okay, and then he asked for his release and then he was gone.
Right.
And like with this, it's like, oh, we knew, what, 2-3 months ago that Dean was leaving?
Yeah, so, I'm going to say that's the thing.
So
Punk was a toxic situation, right?
Right.
So, that, like, I can't take that one. Cody wasn't toxic. Cody got to walk away on decent terms. And Brandy, I mean, they just let her go because it was kind of like, I don't think she was as integral of a part of what was going on either, right?
No. Because, like, she was just a ring announcer.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like the A ring announcer, right?
No.
So, yeah. Renee is like a vital part of the show, right?
Right.
I also think that, I think, but like I said, most of it's rumor and innuendo. And you can't trust anything anymore, man. People throw anything on the sheets because people just want to have content that gets clicks. So, you can't trust nothing that's really out there. And a lot of these guys, even the guys who were famous, credible people, man, they hacks now. And I don't know if they're hacks or they just got too much. See, back in the day, it'd be like one reliable source would call in and tell people stuff, and then that would get circulated, yada, yada, yada. But now, it's kind of like everybody getting something from everywhere. And I'm not telling you some stuff true or not true. It's hard to filter the information.
Yeah, it's all over the place. You got people just throwing information out there, and they're just saying stuff. And it's like, oh, well, it was reported by this person, that person, whatever, whatever, but you don't know what's true and what's not true. Because there's spoilers going to get, quote-unquote spoilers that get thrown out there. There's rumors of people leaving, people coming or going or whatever the hell, and you really don't know, like, what the real situation is until, you know, that time comes, and then that's when you find out if this is true or not. But I don't trust anything that didn't come from the company itself, or it didn't come from, like, that person, because at the end of the day, like, those are only reliable sources there is at this point. I mean, unless somebody did an interview with, like, that person, or, like, they, you know, if they have an inside, if they're on the inside, like, entirely, then maybe, but, like, everything has to be questioned these days because, you know, people just put stuff out there for attention. Like, they will literally just post things and comment on stuff and write whole articles just for attention. Like, it could be something that's completely not true and just completely false, but they'll throw it out there, you know, just for the attention. Because then we have conversations like this about just something that was rumored or, you know, something that I seen or heard or whatever. And it's like, well, that's not true at all, you know? It can be nowhere near close to being factual, but it's out there for everybody to see. So now it becomes a conversation. Regardless of if it's true or not, now it's a conversation. And then it just becomes a big hypothetical what if, and it starts to get, you know, really get around.
Right.
There's been, you know, there's been rumors that have been addressed by the company itself, you know what I'm saying, maybe in, like, written into a storyline or just on live, you know, or whatever, because it was so big and so spread out, like, they had to do something. And that is the craziest part about it all, is, like, it could be something that's completely false, but because it's been put out there in the world, like, now it has to be addressed. So now whoever wrote it or whoever put it out there, like, how you keep talking about Dave Mitzler. Okay, yeah. He has been a reliable source of information up until recently, where stuff has just been put out there. And by him, and it's like he hasn't checked the sources, and sir, like, this is completely false, like, what the fuck? So it's now just become a point where it's, now you gotta question everybody. Now everybody's sources gotta be questioned. And that is hard. That's hard. You know? Especially if you're a blogger or a journalist or whatever, like, you have real reliable information, but now everything is being trusted just because of one person or one thing or whatever. It's rough.
Yeah, okay. I've said it on the show before, Meltzer's a hack who long has lost his credibility. But that, I'm going to leave it at that. We'll walk away from it. Back to Raw. Elias defeats No Way Jose. Nothing really important there. Elias announced himself as the musical act for WrestleMania. We'll see. Kurt Angle defeats Chad Gable in his farewell tour, because he's going, and the thing is, he's going to beat everybody for the next 2 weeks all the way up to WrestleMania. But he announced his final opponent for will be at WrestleMania for his final match will be Baron Corbin. And the internet is not happy. The internet, like, the that internet, fucking sucks.
The internet, the fans, just, like, everybody is pissed. Everybody's pissed. They're like, this is bullshit. Like, are you serious? This is complete bullshit. Like, what the fuck? Like, they are pissed. They are pissed. Every single blog post, whatever, like, there hasn't been one person I've seen so far that agrees with this match. At all. Like, every single post I've seen, every single blog I've seen, article, whatever, nobody agrees with this match. Everybody's like, this is complete bullshit. Like, what are you thinking? Like, are y'all serious right now? Baron Corbin? No.
Here's the thing. I think what it is that they want something for Corbin. Like, they feel like this thing should work. The guy isn't horrible on the mic. He has a good size to him. He actually is decent in the ring. He's very agile. He makes some very athletic moves, like the little thing where he spins around under the rope and all that stuff. Like, the guy can really do some stuff. It just doesn't click. He's right. Never clicked, mm-hmm. Right? In NXT, he didn't click. He won Money in the Bank and people still went no more. He's one of the few people who have lost Money in the Bank because it just doesn't click somewhere. They think this is an opportunity for at least to click. I mean, as a heel, people don't, they don't hate him enough. They don't dig him enough. Like, it just, it's something missing there. Now.
Right.
They even played the angle with him and Reigns, and people just weren't responsive. But people think there should be a bigger match for Angle going out. The problem is, who do you have, right? Undertaker right now is not booked for WrestleMania, and I don't think they're going to do an Undertaker match that hasn't been promoted less than 2 weeks out, right?
No.
Now.
No.
I've heard a lot of people suggest this one. Now, here's the thing, too. If Undertaker did it, he'd have to win, and I don't know if you want to do that to angle going out for his last match, right?
Right.
The other suggestion that I've heard that actually makes a lot of sense is John Cena.
Mm-hmm.
Cena, I think, actually would be the perfect opponent.
Right.
Cena could lose and it still not be like that bad. Like, I think they could make that work with Cena. Cena would lose and angle, but maybe Cena could win. Cena could win, and I mean, you know, because people don't really win their last match either. So Cena could win, and people could dig that too. Like, it's not really, it wouldn't be that bad. But yeah, I think you'd have a bigger name. Like, it would be fitting of an all-time great and a multiple-time champion if he went out against, I guess, another all-time great. Because I think the thing is, Baron Corbin just doesn't have the resume or the status. But, I don't know. Teacher's own, right? Sasha Banks defeats Natalya via DQ. Beth Phoenix and Natty are there. They want a title shot at WrestleMania. After the match just ends in chaos. Well, not really chaos, but after the match ends, Nia and Tamina come down, who eventually kick everybody butt. Keish, this is what I smell for WrestleMania. Right now, Boston Hug, a.k.a. Bayley and Sasha, do not have an opponent for their tag team titles.
Mm-mm.
I smell a fatal four-way coming.
Mm-hmm.
With Nia, Tamina, of course, Beth Phoenix and Natty, because Beth Phoenix wants to get in this mix. And then the Iconics, who have been fishing for a title shot.
Right.
I think we decided to go Fatal 4-Way for that match. It'd be a cross-brand match with people from different brands.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they expect. So I think they will go.
Now, I wonder if they're going to create a second set of women's tag team titles, you know, one for Raw, one for SmackDown, or if they're just going to have one set for right now, you know? I guess I'm wondering if they're just going to see how it fares out.
Yeah, for the most part.
If they're going to create it for the other show, or if they're just going to, you know, or they're going to end up kind of scrapping it at some point.
No, I think for the most part, they are going to keep it, we're cross-brand. So, technically, these titles are supposed to be able to be defended on all three brands. And the champs have made appearances on all three brands. Because that, the idea would be is that right now, I don't think they feel like they have the depth to try to do titles on both shows.
Right. This is true.
And that would mean they would have to put people, how do I say this? They'd have to put more time into the women on each show.
Mm-hmm.
They'd have to make sure that the women's division on each show showcased more talent. Because, I mean, they have a roster. They have a deep roster.
Right.
But I don't know if they know how to manage it that way. So, right now, like, you forget about some of the women that are on the shows. If I, like, Dana Brooke challenged her for the world title, make you think, like, damn, where Dana Brooke been?
Right.
Alicia Fox. Who knew, right? Like, what was Alicia Fox up to?
Mm-hmm.
When's the last time you seen Mickie James?
I don't even remember, to tell the truth.
Like, I thought about that the other day. I was like, damn, like, I ain't seen her on TV or nothing in forever. Like, that's a great question, because that's a mystery to me.
Right.
You know? Like, that's foolishness, though.
Yeah, man.
But I get what you're saying. I definitely get what you're saying. There is not enough woman power right now for there to be two sets of tag team titles. But I do like the fact that they have built it up to where, you know, it's the hottest thing out there. I mean, not just because they're new. I mean, just in general, you know what I'm saying? Because even when the idea was put out there, but it didn't happen yet, you know, women were kind of like, you know, yeah, like, if I get a good partner, I can come out here, we can do this together. You know, like, when you have a tag team like the Iconics, it's different from when you have a Bayley and a Sasha, or because the Iconics, to me, they, even from in NXT, the way that they were put together, it's like,
well, they've always been a team, right? Like, they've never been separate. They've always been together.
So their success is, they definitely have an advantage over the other tag teams, because the other tag teams weren't necessarily, they weren't together. They weren't always together like the Iconics. They were just single.
Yeah, there's two individuals that were put together.
Right.
For the purpose of, like, we got to fill this thing out. Now, they had enough of them to do it, but, yeah, like, there's only been really one real women's tag team since we've, like, rebranded the women's division. So, yeah, that's happening. Ricochet defeats Jinder Mahal. Ronda Rousey beats up Dana Brooke and then faces security again and then beats up security. Her husband takes down a security person and they have to walk out, and Ronda's just losing it. I don't know how much I like this. I mean, it's okay. This is what I'll say. Ronda does not need to talk.
All right.
I think they did a good job this week, like, not no talking. Just come, beat up people, and leave. Let your fighting be intimidating enough, and leave. Like, no more talking. Like, you can't sell this. That's not your strength in this. It's not. Right. Your strength is not built in the conversation.
Mm-mm.
Apollo Crews defeated Baron Corbin. Batista told the world why he mad. And what he had plans to do with Triple H at this No Holds Barred match at WrestleMania. Keisha, I'll say this. I just hope the WWF, in their infinite wisdom, promotes the Avengers movie. Avengers Endgame. You might as well promote it. Start getting it cracked.
Yeah, they really do.
Because get that cross promotion going. Y'all got to start. I think they ruined it in the first Guardians movie, and they just never was able to recover from that. Not understanding that, like, yo, man, you got a legitimate movie star here. Drew McIntyre defeated Seth Rollins. That match ended because Brock Lesnar came down, distracted Seth, and then Drew got the Claymore click. But before that, really good match. And I want to see more from these guys. So, the narrative is that Drew has beaten Dean and Seth. Now he wants Roman. Will he get Roman at Mania? Of course. Not officially booked yet, but you know that match is going to happen. So with that, we're going to take our break. I'm going to play my promo we've set up for this week, because we're going to talk about that into the show. And let's see. Make sure I got the thing right. Oh, I'm in the wrong place. I was about to say, what the hell? Yeah, that would make sense. That's why the thing I was looking for wasn't there. Yeah. So I'll do this. We'll be back, and we'll talk some more stuff.
Honestly, I'm not even surprised. I'm not even surprised. Of course, Vince brought somebody else to fight you because there was never any chance for you to actually win.
It doesn't matter. He beat five, they'd bring out another five. Exactly. He beat those 10, he'd bring out another five.
It doesn't matter.
I'm telling you, after an over an hour in the gauntlet, he did it once. He did it again. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The
they
glass ceiling is
care.
Still there. He'll punch through that glass ceiling.
Kofi,
you'll punch through that glass
they
ceiling. They'll just put another one there.
This,
it doesn't matter. What
this
else?
Is what,
what else have we done here? What more do we have to do here?
Every time you get a shot, there's hurdle after hurdle after hurdle. You put your life on the line. You put your body on the line. You put everything on the line for 11 years. That's no loyalty given back to you.
What more do you have?
That is your reward, Kofi. What happened tonight?
To give here?
That is the reward.
11 years. Why are we doing this anymore?
There's
why
no
are we
reason.
Doing this, Kofi?
There's no reason.
Kofi, you've done a lot in your career.
There is absolutely no reason that should happen. So, matter of fact, you know what? I think we should quit. Honestly, if I'm being honest, I think we should quit.
Hey, honestly, on, you've done a lot here. I agree. I think we should quit, too.
No, that's not.
We've done everything we can here.
Kofi.
Everything we can. Vince McMahon showed it himself. That's as high as you're going to get.
Yeah.
That's it, Kofi.
And that's the man
and
in
it's
charge.
Not you. It's not you because you showed everything.
Exactly.
You showed how good you are on a weekly basis.
Yeah.
This last month, for 11 years, you showed it every night. And this is it.
This is the casino. And this is them telling us you can't beat the house. That's exactly what they want everybody to understand. And they're using you. They're using us as an example to show that. So if they're going to do that, that's the loyalty
Kofi,
that they show after
home.
All this time.
Let's go home, Kofi. You got kids.
It's not like we
you
don't
can,
have other skills.
Kids. Let's go home.
That's why we're so important because we can
hey,
do everything
enough,
else.
Let's just,
that's why they love us so much.
Think about it. You can go home. You can see your kids, man.
On
a weekly basis. Think about it. Why, what
you
are we doing here?
Trust me when I tell you, man. I've been doing this for 11 years, man. I understand. I feel like I've done everything the right way. I've done everything by the book.
And of course you have.
Yes.
You have. You have. You've done it all.
Find another mountain at the top of a mountain. You know what I'm saying?
They put. And this is going to put another mountain
exactly.
on top of that.
That's what it is.
You climb that mountain, they'll put another mountain on top
trust
of that.
Me
it doesn't end.
I get it. But if we quit, then Vince wins. Then Daniel Bryan wins, man. We can't quit. Not like this.
Come on.
I know emotions are high, man.
I get it.
Emotions are running high right now. I think we need to just take some time and figure it out.
Yeah.
You know? But I need to get out of this building, first and foremost, man.
Right.
I need to get out of this building.
It's worth thinking about, man.
Yeah. That's
we can
it?
Go home.
And
you got
let,
kids, you got a wife, you got a family.
I've been doing this since I was 17.
That's
Kofi.
A long time, man. You
I
put
love
in work.
This. I love this. But if it's not going to love me back... I can't be in that relationship anymore.
Let's talk. Fine. Let's go.
Let's talk here.
Come on.
We got you. Good. Come on. You got him. I got the jackets.
All right. We are back. Hope you enjoyed the break. Because that is going... What you heard on the break will be a discussion piece for later on in the show. But here we are at birthdays. We are in the middle of... Well, towards the end of March... And no birthday today or yesterday. Lana celebrates her birthday. Lana turns 34 tomorrow, March 24th. Also on March 24th, Jack Swagger, winner of his first MMA match, turns 37. Wow. Whew. This stuff gets crazy. Christopher Daniels is on Keish, March 24th. This thing is loaded with birthdays. D'Angelo De Niro, the Pope, celebrates a birthday tomorrow on Sunday. The Pope turns 41. So I got Jack Swagger. Christopher Daniels turns 48 tomorrow. Barry Horowitz turns 59. Jobber, pat himself on the back. Barry Horowitz. Epico Cologne turns 37 tomorrow. Lacey Evans turns 29 tomorrow. And she just walks down to the ring and just don't do nothing. But the big birthday is The Undertaker, Keish. The Undertaker got a birthday tomorrow? Well, like I said it surprisingly, like the man don't have a birthday. I'm assuming he have a birthday. Like the dead man thing is just a gimmick, right? So, 1965, that's going to make him what, 54? Mm-hmm. Keshia. Whoo. Hey, man.
Right.
But, like I said, he's not currently booked for WrestleMania, but he is booked for Saudi Arabia. I have no idea who the opponent's going to be, but he is booked for Saudi Arabia. So, yeah, that's it for birthdays. Oh, to the news. Y'all know I like the news. Okay, so Robbie E debuts in NXT. He is a manager, not even as an in-ring performer right now. He's managing a tag team like some Indian cats. I think manager's on their way back, Keish. I think the idea of managers is coming. Look at the emergence of Leo Rush. Even though they're still using him in the ring now, look at the emergence of Leo Rush as a hype man, a.k.a. manager. Paul and Brock, that thing is classic. They hired Stokely Hathaway off the indies. And Stokely is definitely not in any kind of shape to be a wrestler. So I think he's definitely going to be a manager there. And that's just most of his reputation. So they got him at the Performance Center. They're going to really try to make managers and come up with more managers. And I'm excited for it. Jim Ross is in talks with AEW, All Elite Wrestling. You know, his contract with WWE is coming to an end and will not be renewed. Which they always do that, JR. So, yeah. Just, I think he'd be a good stabilizing force over there at AEW. Because as talented as Cody is, and the Bucks, and Jericho, and Kenny Omega, and people who are in the leadership over there, most of them just kids, right? Or when I say kids, they're just young people.
Right.
You know, some of those guys have been in the game 15 years or so, but they're still young. I think Ross brings that sage wisdom that you can't really, you know, buy or duplicate. So,
right.
And that's just not talking commentary. I'm talking about I'm trying to run a wrestling promotion. So, yeah, that's happening. WWE announced the Warrior Award winner for this year, and her name is Sue Aitchison. She is a superstar employee from behind the scenes at the actual WWE. You know what this means, Keish?
What's
that? They actually giving somebody the award for what it was meant for.
Mm-hmm.
Look, right. I ain't got nothing against kids who's sick and Make-A-Wish kids and people like that, but that wasn't what this award was about. Or adults who weren't feeling well. No, this award, Warrior said at the Hall of Fame, was for people who worked behind the scenes and were the unsung heroes that did get all the shine of the glory. Now we're finally doing that. Shouts out to the WWE. Also, in talks with AEW, Jim Johnstone is open to working with AEW. Jim Johnstone is the legendary composer of many of your favorite WWE theme songs. Him and the company parted ways last year, and I guess he's just been chilling. But, yeah, he's open to working with, I think, once again, somebody they can really use over at that company. You got new cats and young bucks out there learning the game, yada, yada, yada. You take a guy who's been in the business for a while, he'd be very helpful. I think what they're going to need is branding and identity, and to have somebody in-house who can make music for you that will shape to your talent, I think is an invaluable thing. You talk about Undertaker might not be at Mania, but he'll be in Saudi Arabia. Keith, WWE is leaving Titan Towers. They are considering moving their headquarters to another location in Stamford, Connecticut. I don't know how much the old building costs, but man.
Yeah, right. Man, yeah. I just couldn't imagine them not being in Titan Tower. You know what I'm saying? Like, that building is nostalgic. Like, I don't see them in another building. Like, I never thought that they would move out of there, to the truth. So, and the one they're moving into, they'll be leasing for a few years, and then like they'll be ready for a few years and whatever. But I'm like, Titan Power is like a job. You know, I don't know, man.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. I'm interested to see the new building, how big it's going to be, because, I mean, this the current building is monstrously huge. Then it's kind of like...
I wonder what I don't know. I mean, I guess, in a sense, I just wondered, like, you know, where do they go from here? You know, sometimes you just...
I'm assuming they already got a spot scoped out, right? Here's the thing, too. They might just be... They probably got the land scoped out. It might want to just build.
Right. True.
True, true.
So...
You know.
That's what would be interesting.
I know this... But this ain't... You know, this ain't the Attitude Era. You know, they're not filming... promos and stuff from the building anymore, or that kind of thing. So, yeah, I can understand why selling the building and then moving would be a more lucrative idea for them to engage in, as opposed to keeping Titan Towers. Because if it's not, you know, if they don't need that much space, or you know, if they don't, they are not doing half of the things that Titan Towers was meant to accomplish, then, you know, there's no point in keeping the building. So, I really do wonder how much they're going to sell it for, because that building has historical value when it comes to wrestling. So,
yeah.
It ain't just the building.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. This is kind of crazy.
I don't either.
Mm-hmm. This is what I would suggest. Historic landmark, right?
Right.
Y'all move the day-to-day operations of offices to another building. I say you make Titan Tower a museum.
Oh, that would be awesome.
You
if
make it...
Do, I'm flying to Connecticut as soon as it opens. I swear to God.
You make it a museum, and you open up a wing to have a physical Hall of Fame.
Right.
Where people can walk in and check out, you know, like the NFL Hall of Fame, and then you just make it a WWF History Museum.
Right. Oh, man, that would be awesome. And then they can hold the Hall of Fame ceremony there.
Yes.
You know, they can have all of the pictures and everything there. I love that idea. That would be awesome. Oh, that would be amazing. So, I'm for it. All for it. I just hope that they would do something like that. Like, instead of just selling it.
Yeah.
Like, that would be, to me, the next best option to in order to make an income off of it.
Yeah.
So, I now that you don't put it out there, now that's all I can think about. So I feel like it just that was on for, but I think that is what they would want as well. So it's
yeah,
we'll figure it out. We will figure it out.
So, with that, I think I got the news covered. SmackDown. The Miz addresses the SmackDown crowd and hits them with some real emotion. And they do a lot of talking. And he's ready for his match with Shane McMahon.
Right.
I'm still not interested. But I think The Miz did a good job. The crowd was cheering him. And they're going to be behind him. The Iconics defeated Bayley and Sasha in a non-title match. Maybe they should be added to that fatal. They should make it a fatal four-way with those teams.
Yeah, true. Mm-hmm.
Becky and Charlotte Flair brawl during the KO show. Keish, does Becky look healthy? Because it would seem like it to me.
No. I feel like she's testing it every time she gets into the ring or walks or whatever. Like, she needs to just heal. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't see why she just won't, you know, take that sit down and just heal. Like, I understand the storyline is over, blah, but in real life, like, I need for her to be more mindful of her actions and how it can harm her in the long run. Because, yeah, you might not get that help now that you need, but you might end up getting it later. It could end up hurting you or, you know, whatever the case may be.
Right.
So, I don't really support it too much. Man, I just see.
Right.
So I personally think that eventually they get to a point. I just feel like it's necessary.
Right.
You know. Yeah. Like, I don't know.
Well, so the show ends with the gauntlet match. Kofi Kingston. He has to go through five men. If he beats the five men, he gets his title shot at WrestleMania. He beats the five men. And then there's one more after that, because Daniel Bryan comes out. After Kofi has spent everything and then got and then went through everything to get there. So that takes us to our post-show, well, not post-show, but the questions after that, our discussion questions. First one, Keish, will Kofi go all the way? Based on what you're seeing now and what you see, will Kofi go to that next level?
I don't know. And if he does, I got a feeling they won't be in WWE. I hate to say it that way, but I think that this whole storyline with him has been more than just that. You know what I'm saying? Like, and I'm not saying that it's not all a work. What I'm saying is the things that people are saying about wrestling these days has already been known to true wrestling fans for years and years and years and years. It's just that I have a distaste for the entire storyline in general. Since the day that it actually physically started. And I believe Kofi has the potential to take it all away. You know what I'm saying? I feel like he should be somewhere at the top. But I feel that gets pulled from him. You know what I'm saying? And it's to a point where everybody's frustrated. You know, and it shouldn't even have to be this way. Kofi's fight has fought hard his entire career. He's earned every single accolade that he has. It's not like Kofi is not a horrible wrestler. You know what I'm saying? Like, if he was terrible in the ring, we'd be having a whole different conversation.
Yeah, no, here's
but
the
he's
thing.
Not.
This is where I think we're at. They've stumbled onto an angle, and how they proceed going forward is everything. As you heard the promo in the middle of the show, the New Day talking about the glass ceiling, how they gonna get out, yada, yada, yada. This angle went semi-racial without going racial.
Yeah, it did.
Right?
And a quickness.
And they're trying to avoid actually going racial. They're actually trying to avoid saying, hey man, this is as far as they're going to go for a black dude. Like, when they say a guy like me probably won't win the title or whatever, they're talking about a black dude. But they can't say it like that because, okay, here's some things. Vince and the shareholders do not want to go into that realm. They're afraid of losing advertisers. They don't want to make it seem like this, and then they don't want their names associated with it, because if Vince got to play the bad guy, even though he's playing a role, it's kind of hard to explain on a conference call.
True.
They want to hit at it, but they don't want to say it. But that's what we're dealing with. And I think scared money don't make none. And you just got to be flat out with it. Like, yo, this is the thing we did for the show. Try to prove something. Yada, yada, yada. But if he's going to get the WrestleMania match, Keish. I got that much. Do they believe in him enough for him to win it?
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like it's there.
Right.
It's definitely there. You know, I just feel that, you know, he don't get what he deserves.
Right.
That's all. That's really the simple end-all and be-all of it. He's getting what he deserves. And it's to a point where, and now, you know what, now it's to a point where it's like, when will he get that opportunity? When will he get the chance to be on top? Because if he has to go to another company in order to do it, so be it.
Here's the thing. They're not going anywhere. I think everybody's still in the contract. But hypothetically, if they were to leave, there's no other place where it would be as big. So it's just kind of, I don't know. WWE tends to make the wrong decisions in these spots. Booker T challenged Triple H for the World Heavyweight title when he was on Raw.
Man, when I tell you
WrestleMania 19.
That has been wrestled many times in conversations about the whole Kofi situation.
Yeah. You know why? Because that angle was just flat out racist. Like, they didn't even try to conceal the racism in that one. Triple H, I think, called a boy one time. Like, it went bad. Booker T should have won that match at WrestleMania 19.
He should have. And every single person that I've seen talk about that match has said that exact same thing. There has not been one time where I have seen someone say, you know, nah, Triple H should have won. No. Booker should have won that match. That title should have been his that night.
And that wasn't even like the WWE title. That was the World Heavyweight title. Because here's the thing.
Exactly.
The WWE title has never been held by a black person. Now, I know y'all going to say The Rock, right? I'm not trying to take The Rock's blackness away from him. But for the last few years, he's just been selling me by his Samoan heritage. No. Mm-mm. Not doing it.
You're right.
Yeah.
So, I personally want, and it's funny how they have found ways around it. Like,
right.
They gave Mark Henry the ECW title and then the World Heavyweight title, and, you right. know, they found ways around it, but it's still a fact that this is what it is. And I just personally feel Kofi deserves that chance. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And it's not like he hasn't worked. But to tell the truth, if he won that title, he'll be a Grand Slam champion. Right. So it's not like he hadn't worked for it. You know what I'm saying? It ain't like I ain't worked for it. Kofi has many championships, singles titles. As a matter of fact, he's the most decorated member of the New Day. So how is it that, you know, he doesn't deserve that spot? Kofi remains a great champion. Period. The end. Like, he'll be entertaining. He'll be everything you want him to be. But just not to have that. I feel like the storyline went left after Black History Month. And that, to me, was just the biggest slap in the face anyway. And then, on top of that, I'm like, I don't understand why y'all decided that this is the direction y'all wanted to go into. but I hate it all. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Like, and you're kind of like, if y'all go be here. But I'll say this.
Right.
Like I said, Kofi was an accident. Kofi wasn't meant to be this big. The fans just like would let up on it, and I think that's where we are.
Right.
I'll wait to see how it all plays out. I think it'd be interesting. I think there's a lot that can be said for it. And I can't wait to see how it plays out.
True.
The next topic of discussion, Keish. Who the hell is Asuka going to face at WrestleMania?
I hate the fact that ever since she has won the SmackDown Women's title, she's just kind of been thrown into the background. Because they're focused so much on Sasha and Bayley and Ronda and Becky and Charlotte. It's like, damn, like, where the hell? Y'all got a whole nother women's champion out here. Like, y'all have a whole nother women's champion out here. And the fact that y'all brought her out just so that, you know, just to say, hey, we have her here. It's like, no, she's a champion. She has a belt. You know what I'm saying? Like, she's not just one of the superstars in the back. She is a champion.
Right.
Give her the credit that she deserves. Give her her justice. As a champion, she deserves to have some kind of spotlight. When was the last time we seen Asuka on TV? You know what I'm saying? When was the last time
that they talked
about Asuka?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like,
yeah, I mean, this week.
Right now, it pisses me off because
she's completely missing.
Like, why are you doing her like that? She's a champion.
Here's the thing. They took her top two contenders and their top two contenders are challenging for the Raw title, right? So,
right.
This show fought around Charlotte and Becky. That's going over to Raw. So, Six Junior got to come up with something.
I don't understand. And that's fine. Okay. That's cool. But now you have to create a space to where there's some kind of chase or, you know, or strive or something for the SmackDown Women's title because you can't just focus on the Raw Women's Championship.
Right.
You have a whole nother Women's Champion out here. You know what I'm saying? Like, in NXT, it took nothing to get Shayna Baszler a match. Like, it pretty much created itself. With the whole Raw Women's Champion thing, yeah, of course Becky was going to choose Ronda because, you know, that's who she'd been wanting to face. She was supposed to face in the first place. So now, you know, I can understand the story I did around that. But you have to include your other women's champions. Y'all focusing so much energy on the Raw Women's Championship and the tag team and the women's tag team titles that you've forgotten that you have a whole other champion. And then I feel like her match is going to end up, y'all got to create a match for a WrestleMania. It's WrestleMania. Every single title has to be defended. Every single one. All of them. And in order to do that, you got to give her an opponent. And I feel like they're going to throw her somebody out of thin air. She's going to end up on a kickoff show somewhere, and it's going to piss me off. Because she don't deserve that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, Asuka isn't just Asuka. You know what I'm saying? Asuka went 2 years undefeated. Asuka was the first winner of the Women's Royal Rumble. You know what I'm saying? Like, Asuka was the last woman standing at Survivor Series over Raw Tees. Like, Asuka is not just Asuka.
Right.
You know, she's not just one of the regular wrestlers in the back. You know, we're not talking about like a Dana Brooke here. I have nothing against her. I'm just saying, like, this is not the same story. And she never gets the respect that she deserves. And that irks me. Like, regardless of if she's holding the title or not, it's like ever since her undefeated streak was broken, they just decided to do whatever they want with her. And it's like, why are y'all treating her like that? You know? She's one of your champions. She is one of your champions. And she doesn't have a match for WrestleMania. How the hell does that work? You know, y'all focusing all y'all energy on this whole Kofi situation, and you know, and I understand, like, everything has to have its attention, but at the same time, everything has to have its attention. You have to give that attention to her. You have to give her that space. You know, you got to give her what she deserves. And I'm not talking a 5-minute match either. Like, y'all got to give her something. She's the SmackDown Women's Champion. She has to have a match at WrestleMania. Like, there's no way around it. Period. Every single title should be defended. All of them. And if she's not defending it, you know, it's like, what are we doing here? I think about the same thing when it comes to the Raw tag team titles. You know, SmackDown did a really great job at, you know, creating a storyline for the SmackDown tag team titles. Raw threw that shit to the side. I mean, for a while, I had forgot that Bobby Roode and Chad Gable were the tag team champions until they lost their titles. So that lets me know that there's a lack in creative when it comes to that, too. You got to give y'all champions the attention they deserve. You have to give them somebody to challenge. You need to give them a storyline. You need to make them relevant. They're your champions. Every single person that holds a belt deserves spotlight. Period. The end. That's it. Like, and it's not like y'all don't have the time to do it. Raw got 3 hours.
Tell me about it.
And y'all still go over the time.
Tell me about it.
Because y'all end that show at 11 o'clock. So yeah. I don't understand how is that y'all don't have enough time to give them the 15 minutes that they deserve.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? SmackDown is 2 hours. But y'all have enough. Y'all don't have the roster that Raw has. So y'all have the time. That's all I'm saying. Y'all have the time. You know what I'm saying? I give you a perfect example. NXT does a wonderful fucking job at giving their champions, all their champions, the attention they deserve. When it comes to the NXT title, the women's NXT title, the tag team titles, and the North American champion, all of them get time. It might not be, because it's a 1-hour show, it might not be all in one night. But at the same time, every single champion is mentioned on every single show at some point. And they get the attention they deserve. I don't get how y'all don't translate that into the main shows. Like, it just boggles my mind. I can't understand it. So, with Asuka not having a match for WrestleMania, there has been a huge hole and lack in y'all planning, y'all writing, and y'all creative team. Somebody needs to be fired.
Yeah.
I'm just saying. That definitely has to happen. Like, that irks me. And then stuff in situations like this that end up on a kickoff show somewhere where they're not even seen on a main show. And it's like, that's some fucked up shit. Like, Yo, Raw Women's Champion finna have a triple threat and it's getting all this goddamn attention. But y'all can't do the same for your SmackDown Women's Champion? Like, what kind of shit is that?
They put the best competitors in a triple threat for that Raw title. right? They didn't stock the deck back for who's, or and they didn't build up anybody else on that SmackDown roster to be legitimate. They tried to do a rush job with Mandy Rose, but I just don't think people were buying it, even for Fastlane.
It was horrible.
And they didn't follow. And they didn't follow up with it either, right?
No. So
that's kind of where we are with that. So Asuka is the woman on the island without an opponent. Really, I was supposed to put more holes in the WrestleMania card, but that's pretty much like we're going to have the women's Fatal 4-Way probably for the tag titles. Right. The Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal is going to go down. My early favorite is Braun Strowman. We'll probably have the Women's Battle Royal, even though I haven't said much about it. Keesh, this show is going to be like 7 hours. Look, they talk about pre-show starting at like 5 o'clock. Main show starting at like 7. Then you know when they'll go up to like 12. Like, Keesh, I got to start taking naps already.
but you know what? That also adds to my point. Look how long we're talking about for one damn show. And y'all don't have a match for the women's title? For the SmackDown women's title?
Yeah, yeah.
What kind of shit is this?
Yeah, I don't think it's helpful for anybody involved either. Like, legitimately healthy for anybody involved. Like, I think it's kind of one of those things that's kind of like, I don't think you're helping anybody, but we'll see. No. Like I said, you took your top contenders, and they're not in the match. Do they even work on SmackDown anymore? I mean, they do because they show up at SmackDown. But when they show up on SmackDown, all they do is talking about the Raw Women's title. Now, I would have tried to say that we're one of those women. I would have Becky facing Ronda one-on-one, and Charlotte would have rematched with Asuka, because the rematch is, hey, revenge from last year. Can Charlotte do it again and get her belt back, or can Asuka avenge her only major loss in her first major loss in her first WrestleMania, yada, yada, yada.
I'm going to tell you where all this went left. When they decided that all the McMahon was going to run both shows, that's when all this shit went left. Because ever since that day, shit just started to go haywire. These storylines started to get fucked up. And it's like, what are y'all thinking? I'm just saying, what are y'all thinking?
Well, because they've kind of wrote themselves into a like a corner, because it's just like, okay, Triple H is going to be a babyface, right? Against Batista. Right. Stephanie not really involved this year. Shane did with heel. Vince went heel. So who do you have to balance out? Because Triple H can't go fight everybody for everything. Who's going to balance out what's going on? Like,
exactly. Hey,
you know, you're going out. This, da, da, da. Like, who? I don't know. But yeah, that's all I got.
No,
this
I
week.
Agree with you when it. Yeah, I agree with you 100%, and it's tragic to tell the truth, but I guess we'll just have to wait and see how they're gonna play this out. Cause they only got a couple of weeks before WrestleMania comes, so they gotta do something. You know what I'm saying? And they're gonna throw something together, and it's gonna probably be terrible, and I'm gonna be pissed. So I need them to make sure they play this out correctly, because if not, it's going to be disaster. You know what I'm saying? Like, we've had some bad WrestleManias, so let's not act like, you know, that's not possible. Because I'm pretty sure everybody that has watched every WrestleMania can name a few that have been absolutely fucking terrible.
Yeah. This is where I would say booking matters, and we'll see how it plays out. But with that being said, we have enjoyed talking about all of this stuff, and talking to you, the fans,
sure,
about professional wrestling and what's going on in the world of wrestling. We'll be back next week, probably around the same time, and then we'll get back to our normal schedule somewhere closer to WrestleMania. Hopefully there'll be a few shows dropping over the course of these next couple of weeks to get you guys set up and make you fully understand what's going on. But with that being said, we are out. Peace.
Bye.